Okay, so we're into day two. Thank you so much for all of your full participation, energy, and engagement on day one. And it is now my honor and my pleasure to introduce a longtime partner, advisor, friend, and you know, mentor, Ron Cordes from the Cordes Foundation, who has been working with Ashoka U and our network for many years. And now he's going to take it over and tell us a little bit more about this exciting session to come.
Great, thanks, Bridger. It is exciting to be here. We were just at our table reflecting back on the very first Ashoka U exchange held in a room considerably smaller than this. I think the first Ashoka U exchange, if you would envision these first four tables, that was it. So it's wonderful to have been a partner with Ashoka for the past 4 years, to have participated in the growth of this great initiative that Marina and Aaron and the Ashoka U team have put together. I'm thrilled this year that we're represented by a big team at the Cordes Foundation. So we have my wife, Marty, co-founder, our daughter, Stephanie, vice chair, our executive director, Spencer Tan, our program director, Eric Stevenson. And last, we have one of our board members who I know I've talked about before. It's the guy that got me into all this 6.5 years ago, Jerry Hildebrand, who recently left the University of Pacific as we've now looked to transition the Global Center program from Pacific to another university. But 6.5 years ago, my friend Jerry Hildebrand, as I had sold a business, we'd started a family foundation, and we were thinking about ways in which we could have an impact on the world, Jerry began a center at a university in California and invited me in to meet with the students. And I think that he, in his own diabolical way, knew that if he could get me on campus for a couple of days, I'd be hooked. And I used to say that one day a month or 2 days a semester I was able to get out were my most fun and most energizing 1 or 2 days because of the brilliance and the passion and the enthusiasm of the young change makers. So when I think about what we do here, I think about it, I like to think about it as something I call the spark, which is that aha moment when you realize that you may forever have changed the trajectory of a young life. As an educator, teacher, a parent, it's what you live for. And it's that elusive secret sauce that universities try to find in providing real value for their students. Bill Drayton has so brilliantly talked about the everyone a changemaker concept, and now Ashoka U has taken that to the next level with changemaker campuses. And so we're thrilled to be involved with the Ashoka U Cordes Innovation Awards, because what we believe is for the schools that are creating those sparks, we want to highlight those innovations, whether they be in the classroom, whether they be outside of the classroom, whether they be from a third-party organization, nonprofit, for-profit, social enterprise. We try to cast a wide net and look for the best and brightest innovations that are really affecting the ability of our students to be change makers. 220 applicants in 2014, our biggest application group yet. 6 2014 awardees, you'll be meeting and hearing from each one of them in just a moment, and 24 innovations soon to be featured. There's 18 up there now from the last 3 years, soon to be featured on a really cool portal that Ashoka U has developed. So I'd encourage all of you to go back up and look at it. It's part of the mission of these awards is that each awardee, 2014 and the last 3 years, is given an opportunity to have a place on that portal with video and text and attachments so that they can feature and highlight what they're doing. And so that most importantly, another university might look at it and say, we should consider replicating that. Because one of the things that we strive for is programs that can be replicated and can be scaled. And again, we strive for finding best practices and highlighting them. I do want to point out before we announce and introduce our winners that there is a judging committee of which I'm privileged to sit on. Chris Crane, the president and CEO of Edify, Stephen Huddart from the J.W. McConnell Foundation, Regina Ridley, Publishing Director of the Stanford Social Innovation Review, Jacqueline Smith from Arizona State University, and Greg Van Kirk, an Ashoka Fellow, and the co-founder of the New Development Solutions Group. So the small group of us, with great support from the Ashoka staff, have the opportunity to go through lots of applications, see lots of great programs. When I met with a group of six winners this morning, what I told them is if they had seen the finalist group that we had looked at, they would know that the six behind them and the six behind them, et cetera, were all terrific programs. So it was not an easy decision, but we're really proud and pleased of the six that we're about to introduce you to. So what I'd like to do, as we bring up our first awardee, is I'd like to bring up our co-presenter this morning, the president of Ashoka, Diana Wells, who's also a member of the Board of Trustees and alumnus here at Brown University. Diana. Good morning. So our first awardee this morning, we actually, one of the awardees came from Brown, so we thought it was only appropriate to start with the home team. So it's the Social Innovation Fellowship and Leading Social Ventures class, Alan Harlem, Lizzie Pollock, and MJ Kaplan from Brown University. Come on over for the photo.
Good morning. My name is Lizzie Pollock. I'm the Assistant Director of Social Entrepreneurship at Brown University.
I'm MJ Kaplan, and I teach Leading Social Ventures at Brown. I'm also affiliated with Victoria University in Wellington, New Zealand, where I did a fellowship last year looking at social enterprise startups and the pipeline in higher ed. We're so honored to accept this award, and we'd like to start by telling you a little bit about the fellowship and the Leading Social Ventures class. The Social Innovation Fellowship is a year-long program for students working on ventures. It includes a paid summer to support their venture development, intensive programming for 1 year, workshops and speakers, and a community, both on campus and off. Leading Social Ventures is an action learning class that we really developed in response to student demand for more support. It complements the fellowships. Many of the fellows take the class, but we also have students who don't have the fellowship that are involved in the class.
We'd like to share a little bit about our track record. The data that you'll see up on the screen is from our 2012 impact report. At the time, we had supported 75 students, and today we've supported 107. We support both entrepreneurs and intrapreneurs, reflecting our focus on the innovative process, the innovation process, not just the product and the result. Our students work on issues ranging from health to education to the environment, and historically about half of our projects are located here in the U.S. and half are abroad. The next statistic that we're particularly proud of is that out of the ventures founded by our fellows, 3 out of 4 still exist today. One of those ventures was founded by a woman named Amelia Friedman, who I met my first month at Brown in October 2012. Amelia had started a new program on campus that involved training international students to teach their peers in their native languages and cultures. At the time when I met Amelia, I didn't understand really what was particularly innovative about this program or where its social impact was. And she didn't either. Today, the Student Language Exchange, just a little over a year later, is now an innovative and potentially disruptive model for teaching cultural awareness and global readiness. They've reached nearly 200 college students. They're poised to expand to 3 new campuses in the next year, and they've secured nearly $30,000 to help support their work. So how did this happen? We'd like to tell you about our theory of change and the 3 elements that we believe make this program unique. The first is community. We believe that innovation is a team expedition and not just a solo climb. Networks are critical to any entrepreneur's success, and so we model this in the fellowship. We build community through retreats, weekly sessions, small group meetings, and intentional community building. And we create a space where fellows can be vulnerable, share challenges, and have some fun together. The network also extends beyond our campus. When students apply for the fellowship, they're paired with advisors, professionals, social entrepreneurs, alumni of Brown, alumni of the fellowship, to support their work, help them hone their proposals and their ideas. And once students are accepted into the fellowship, they're each paired with a professional mentor to work with them throughout the year as a sounding board and personal advisor. For Amelia, this meant that when she submitted her draft proposal, she was paired with three wonderful advisors, including Nabil Galani, who's a Brown alum and founder of CourseSolve.org. Nabil pushed her to think about the student language exchange more strategically and consider how she could measure her impact, totally transforming her model and her mindset.
The second element of the theory of change is co-curricular and academic programming. The class is action learning. The syllabus focuses on emerging trends in social innovation and social enterprise, but all the assignments are practical applications. Students are working on business models, theories around impact, and revenue plans. The fellowship are workshops that are focused on critical skills. It has the feel, in many ways, more like an accelerator, although being that it's an academic environment, we really put a lot of emphasis on the learning and support. Amelia, in her own journey, learned that 1.7 million international students are in the U.S. studying, and she realized there was unrealized potential. She could create a product, a curriculum, that others would pay for. That was something she hadn't considered previously.
The third element of our theory of change is summer immersion. We give all of our fellows funding so they can work on their ventures full time over the summer. They take all of the ideas that have been in their heads for months and months and put them out into the world. They have the opportunity to try and to sometimes fail, an experience that's unfamiliar to many Brown students. Amelia's summer was spent really solidifying her model, creating resources, building an all-star team, and even establishing herself as a thought leader in the space. She was invited to be a regular blogger for the Huffington Post and published her first blog.
Amelia's is just one story of dozens. Hers took off, many crash and burn. But what we like to focus on is the experience, the learning, and the relationships. We're not just catalyzing ventures, we're changing lives. Thank you so much.
There you go. Great. Congratulations. Congratulations. Our next awardee is Echoing Green's Work on Purpose program. So please welcome up Linda K. Klein from Echoing Green.
Good morning. Let's see if I can figure this out. No.
The green one. Big green one.
Big green one. All right. Good morning. So I'm going to ask you guys some questions, and I just want to say up front that these are actually not rhetorical questions. These are real questions, so I'd love to have your answers to them. So the first question is, how old were you the very first time that you were asked, what do you want to do when you grow up?
Four.
Four. Okay. Four, three. It's like an auction. What else?
Two.
I got a two. Okay. I feel like that's we'll stop there. And now we're getting to like the onesies that just tell you what you're going to grow up as. All right. And since that day, how many times did you estimate that you've been asked that question or some variation of that question, like what are you going to do next year? A thousand. What else? Hundreds of thousands. Okay. Excellent. All right, so next set of questions. How old were you the first time you were asked this question, who do you want to be when you grow up? What kind of person with what kind of impact on other people? 19?
Never.
Never. Mm-hmm. 15? Okay. And how many times since that day do you think that you've been asked that question?
Five.
Okay. So every time I ask these questions, I'm struck by the fact that this first question, what do you want to do when you grow up, is one that we are asked early, and it is one that we are asked often. And the second question, who do you want to be, is one that we are asked late and infrequently, if ever at all. In fact, actually, let's do a little survey. So we heard a never in the room. If you have never been asked, who do you want to be by someone else, what kind of person, raise your hand. Yeah. So even here, in a deeply social impact-oriented space, we have good like 20% of the room. So that is precisely why I'm here today. I'm here because Echoing Green, the organization that I work for, is committed to creating a culture change, a new paradigm in which the chronology and the frequency with which these questions are asked is reversed. You might be thinking this is very interesting information, particularly in light of the fact that, as many of you in this room know, Echoing Green has, for the past 25 years, been best known as a seed-funding social entrepreneurship organization. So we will get back to that. But in the meantime, yes, indeed, we are best known as a seed-funding social entrepreneurship organization. The fellows that you can see on the screen here are just five out of about 600 fellows that we have working around the world in 49 countries. They are addressing multiple issues, from environmental issues to social issues. They're using different models. Some are for-profit, some are non-profit, some are hybrid. And yet, with all of the difference among them, when it comes to what they're doing and where they're doing it, we have seen that there are starkly similar principles and practices that they use to get there. At Echoing Green, we have started to organize these similar principles and practices into three categories in their purpose pathing processes. And these three categories are right for you. These are principles that we see fellows use again and again to help them to understand questions around personal success and personal fulfillment. Good for the world. These are principles that we see our fellows using to help them to develop that nuanced view of what the world really needs so that they're not just working from what they want to give to the world. And then the third category is called Be Bold, and Be Bold are these principles that we see fellows use again and again to help them to develop that boldness and that spirit of risk-taking that allows them to not just dream, but to do. So 3 years ago, Echoing Green launched our Work on Purpose program. And our Work on Purpose program for the last 9 months has been particularly busy traveling around the country, teaching these principles and practices to faculty and staff. In fact, we have taught faculty and staff at 130 colleges and universities and nonprofits in the last 9 months alone. And we work very closely with those faculty and staff to identify white spaces at their particular institution for a place that a purpose-pathing curriculum that teaches these principles could be embedded deeply and over the long term, changing the lives of the emerging professionals that the faculty and staff engage with every single day. So every institution does it a little bit differently. Every institution has different white spaces. So we have some institutions that are actually using the entire curriculum as a first-year experience course. We have some people using it in senior capstone courses. Some people just taking bits and pieces of our curriculum and building it into their existing academic curriculum, such as a social entrepreneurship course. Other institutions are actually using it as their leadership development programming, say for a Bonner Scholars program. Others are using it at their career counseling centers in one-on-one sessions and group sessions. We've actually even had a trend where a lot of faculty and staff have started to use it with each other, which is exciting. So ultimately, because it's used in so many different ways, we've actually invited representatives from two of the institutions who are currently using the curriculum to join us at the networking salon so you can actually hear from them what using the curriculum is like. So we are delighted that we're going to have Tulane University and Brown University, our host university, joining us for that conversation. But in the meantime, I did promise that I would come back to some things, so I want to come back to that. So you heard it that first slide, or you saw in that first slide that we put up, the mission statement of Echoing Green: to unleash the next generation of talent to solve the world's biggest problems. Yes, just a small thing like that. We deeply believe that social entrepreneurs are critical to the success of that mission. And we also believe that they cannot do it alone. And that is why, after a quarter of a century working in squarely in the social entrepreneurship space, Echoing Green has launched a program dedicated to one thing: purpose. We know that we need a robust ecosystem of impact-driven individuals. We need social entrepreneurs. We need social entrepreneurs. We need artist activists. We need high-impact volunteers and donors and nonprofit employees, people who are doing what they need to do in order to be who they want to be. And we were really excited about winning this award in particular because we're an old organization in some ways. And yet, this is a very new chapter of our work. And so this award, the Ashoka U Innovation Corda's Innovation Award, is a moment for us to sit back and sort of honor this new moment in our history, which is, I think, an exciting one. So thank you.
Terrific.
Thank you very much.
Congratulations. Let me give you this.
Next up is the Next Gen Fellowship Program from an organization called Emzingo, and Ramon Marmolejos from Emzingo is accepting the award. Congratulations. We'll get a photo here with you.
Okay, thank you, Ron, thank you, Diana, and thank you to all the organizers of Ashoka U, thank you, Marina, and everyone here. So I'm going to talk to you about Emzingo Group, and Emzingo really is based on a couple of problems. One, we're seeing that business education needs to shift, okay? So first, what we're seeing is that currently schools are creating managers and not leaders, and we desperately need leaders to solve some of the most challenging problems that we have in our world today. The other thing is that students are looking for more meaningful work, and a lot of the students here are part of that trend, right? So how do you incorporate that meaning and doing social good through the work that you're doing? And we also see a trend that education needs to move beyond the four walls. Unfortunately, a lot of education, not just business education, is still based on a very antiquated model of teaching within four walls and not looking at how to do more experiential learning. On the other end, we also see that the civil sector needs desperate help. I've been fortunate to work in the private sector and the public sector, working with nonprofits. But what we see is that there's a demand to do more with less, so fewer resources, but the problems become much bigger and more complex. There's a lack of organizational capacity in a lot of ways. And then there's also this amazing opportunity for market-based solutions. So a lot of the work that you all are doing in terms of social entrepreneurship really brings this idea that you can combine business to do some really amazing good in the world. So I was driven by this question of what if? What if you could release the power of people to make a difference? So just to talk a little bit about myself, I started business school in Madrid at IE Business School and had this idea that there's got to be a better way. I was entering the crisis. I was entering school as the crisis in 2008 just started. And I thought to myself, are we teaching leaders to go off this cliff? And are we teaching them to take us with them? And so could we find a better way to educate our future leaders? And so I created Emzingo along with two other co-founders with this mission of people development through social impact. So the idea is very simple. We're looking to prepare, inspire, and connect this next generation of responsible business leaders, and to think very differently about how to create a connection between the business and the citizen sector. So how do we do this? Principally, our principal program is our Emzingo Next Gen Fellowship. And it's structured as an action learning type of program where we take social impact consultancy projects. We also combine that with a leadership development curriculum that we think is very innovative as it combines what I think are the key competencies that are going to be necessary for the future leaders of the world. And that's really focused around how to manage innovation, how to think about emotional intelligence and self-awareness, how to think about global cross-cultural competency and developing a global mindset. And it's based on this idea of learn, live, and lead. So we combine both the academic piece, the cultural immersion, and then leadership development through these social impact projects. As you see here, there are four components to the program. And what's, I think, innovative of Emzingo is that it takes a very much a holistic approach. So you have the action learning component, right? So you have the project that's reinforced with the leadership development, so they can apply directly what they're learning. And then you have the coach, it's combined with coaching, so each of the participants are actually matched with a professional coach to create a personal development plan, and then there's an element of reflection throughout the process. So what we're talking about is shifting the way we think about leadership, right? So thinking about how do we go from command and control to collaborate and power, from delegating to design, from corporate speak to truth and having an authentic voice, from values to voice, and from moving from performance-based systems that just look backwards to adding an element of play in the way we do our work in order to develop new innovations for the future. So our impact, right? So you see the numbers on the left-hand column, but we want to be very aggressive as we think about our vision for 2020. We're looking to create and connect individuals to projects that will impact over 1 million people in our communities around the world. Right now, we're operating in Peru, South Africa, and we're just opening now in Brazil. And we're excited to continue that expansion. But we need you to help us with that. So for students that are interested, please speak to me or go on our website. For universities that may be interested in bringing Emzingo to your campus, please connect with me as well. And for any companies or social entrepreneurs that are in the space today that would like to collaborate with us or have access to the rich talent of our fellows, please also speak with me. And just really quickly, I wanted to end with a couple of anecdotes. So our impact goes beyond the numbers, really. So on the right-hand side, you have Tulani Mandando, who is one of the founders of Cliptown Youth Program in Soweto, Johannesburg. Cliptown is a fairly poor neighborhood, and as you can imagine, you know, when I walked through those streets a few years ago and I met Tulani, I was just devastated by the amount of poverty and lack of resources and lack of adequate education. And KYP looks to solve that problem by supporting children in those communities and providing tutoring services, education services, and meals every day. On the other hand, we also have Annabelle Lopez, who was an MBA, went through our program. Her plan was to go back to her family business in Venezuela. She went through our program and worked with Tulani. So Tulani, they together created a strategic plan over the next 5 years and understood, okay, how do we take Cliptown Youth Program and amplify their impact? And since then, Tulani has actually been nominated as a global CNN hero and was able to secure 50,000 Rand grant to expand their operations. And since then, Annabelle has moved on to work for the Grameen Creative Lab in Colombia and is about to start the Impact Hub in Caracas, Venezuela. So I leave you with this quote, which is a quote that I leave with all of the students. So the idea here is, how do we make sure that we create solutions that are for the people and by the people that they can implement immediately? And I hope that you can help us at Emzingo to spread our impact. Thank you.
Thank you. That's very good. So our next awardee is City Studio Vancouver. Please welcome Dr. Janet Moore.
Hi. Thanks. Stop, take a picture.
I will trade you.
Trade.
It's a big green button.
Hello. My mic's working. So first, I just wanted to thank you for this award. It's really important to us, and just to express our gratitude that a small project in Vancouver is winning this big award, and we're really excited to be here. So at City Studio, we think place is really important. And so I want you to spend a minute and think about the place where you come from, and not just the city or the town, but the mountain and the river that you come from, and everyone has one. And at City Studio, we're located in Vancouver, which is at the mouth of the Fraser River. It flows about 1,300 kilometers through British Columbia and arrives at the Georgia Strait. And Sir Simon Fraser, where my university was named, was not the first man to be in a canoe and go down this river. In fact, people have been doing that for thousands of years prior to him. And recently, we've renamed those waters, the Salish Sea, to acknowledge the Coast Salish territories in which we live on today in Vancouver. The coastal mountains in Vancouver remind us on a daily basis that there's sort of magnificent presence that commands our presence on our daily commutes to work and to school and to play. It also reminds us that we live on a rainforest, at one point with rivers filled with salmon, an overabundance. Today, we're a port city. We're a city of diversity, of immigrants, of artists, of innovators. And we're also the city in Canada with the poorest postal code. So we have this abundance and we have these inequities, and we think students need to wrestle with these issues as well. So we have climate change issues, we have globalization, we have inequities, the biggest gaps between rich and poor. We also imagine that there's other people to thank. So one of them is a great visionary and leader in Vancouver, Mayor Gregor Robertson in Council, ran in 2008 on the platform of becoming the greenest city in the world by 2020. And they put out a call to the city that said, it was an online crowdsourcing platform that said, what are your best ideas for the greenest city? And I was co-teaching at the time with my co-director, Dwayne Alvarum, who couldn't be here today because he's holding down the fort teaching at City Studio. And he and I said, what would be our idea? And we said, well, we need students inside City Hall. And there was 800 ideas on the platform, and City Studio went up to the top four, and they called us and said, let's get this started. You have 3 months. How are you going to get students inside City Hall? So that's where we began. And they said to us, we don't actually want any more ideas. We have 800. We've been having this action team. What we want to do is see these projects on the ground. We want implementation. We want demonstrations. We want to visualize this future for the population in Vancouver. And who better than students with hope, energy, enthusiasm, and the ones that are going to face these issues for the rest of their lives? So the six universities and colleges in Vancouver got together. It's a collaboration with the City of Vancouver, and we have two key programs. One of them is a cohort program where 20 students, interdisciplinary, undergraduate, from all six institutions, come together for a semester. And this space is actually inside City Hall, and we're an innovation hub at the city. The other program is a network of partner courses across the six campuses where faculty can get projects from the city staff to work on directly. And we use a pedagogy of design thinking and dialogue. Dialogue really slows down the design process and really connects people together, the networks and relationships that are needed. And we ask staff, what's one thing that you could use help with? What do you need help with that's on the side of your desk? And then we ask the students in the community this question that you see. What's the one thing that would make your neighborhood greener, happier, and healthier, and more affordable? And then we issue the City Studio Challenge. So in a group of four, you have one semester to produce a project that lands on the ground. And you have to have these five things. You have to have a city staff on board supporting your project. You have to have other support, write a budget, have funding perhaps. You need a site. That place is really important. And we also need a steward. So after you leave, a community group or a steward will continue your project. And the project should be scalable so that the city can continue it in the future. And if this all comes together, the sixth S is smiles. So we see that in the projects. So to tell you a few projects that we've done, the first semester, they really felt like we needed more dialogue about Greenest City. And they built a 30-foot table, having never built a table before, out of a tree that had fallen in a park. So they hand-milled the table, and this travels around the city now as a place for dialogue on the Greenest City and other projects. Another group of students installed bike repair stations. The city actually had this idea, but hadn't gotten it on the ground. The students launched and piloted two, and now you see them across Vancouver. Another project was a student with a passion for piano and music found a lot of pianos going to the dump on Craigslist. He got them moved, painted them, and put them in public spaces, and our Keys to the Streets program will run again this summer, bringing amazing joy to public space. We've also redesigned community gardens, reimagined wood waste, piloted food scraps composting in multifamily dwellings. We've mapped orphan spaces across the city for future sites for projects. And hopefully we'll be launching an urban campfire project this semester. In 3 years, we've done 53 projects with over 1,700 students engaged. And we're learning a lot. We're learning that small projects matter in ways that we never imagined, and that we're actually bringing joy to city staff and joy to the city. And this is a disruptive innovation. We're disrupting the classroom. We're getting out of lecture halls. And we're also disrupting City Hall, that there's new ways that the universities and the city can work together to find new spaces for innovation. So we invite you all to Vancouver to come and see what we're up to and learn about your projects and come and learn more about City Studio. Thank you.
Next up is the Center for Design Practice at the Maryland Institute College of Art, presented by Mike Weikert. Welcome.
Well, good morning. So I'm Mike, and I direct the Center for Design Practice at Maryland Institute College of Art. So I'm a designer from a design school, and I don't think there are a lot of us here. So I'm particularly honored to be able to share our vision and work with you all this morning. So I'm going to start off with our definition. So we define our center as an interdisciplinary, project-based studio, bringing together students and outside partners from government, nonprofit, and business sectors to collaborate on innovative solutions to social problems. And I'm going to deconstruct this to better demonstrate what we're doing and why we think it's innovative in the classroom. So to start, interdisciplinary project-based. We bring students from different disciplines together from MICA, both at the graduate and undergraduate level, to work on externally funded projects. So far, we've had more than 150 students and faculty from over 10 disciplines and majors come together to work on projects for academic credit. Next, we bring together students and outside partners from government, nonprofit, and business sectors. So every partner that we have brings individuals into the classroom and outside of the classroom, and they work directly with our students. You can see from the slide that the partners are wide and varied. So everything from Whole Foods Market to Johns Hopkins, Bloomberg School of Public Health, to the National Wildlife Federation, and many more. And then finally, collaborate on innovative solutions to social problems. So this isn't a typical fee-for-service design model. So our partners don't come and say, oh, hey, you know, we need a website designed. They come and pose questions like, okay, we're trying to increase HIV testing amongst Latino men in Baltimore City. How can design and the design process help us achieve these goals? So you can see from the slide, we've worked on many issues over the years, from addiction to vacant housing, urban farming, and many more. And we've been able to raise over $750,000 in external project funding. So this is funding that's specifically for us to engage with partners in these projects. And we think the process works. So, for example, our students were working with an organization called Real Food Farm, and they were examining food access issues in Northeast Baltimore. They designed a mobile farmers market that brought the food to the people. Or when we worked with the Baltimore City Health Department to increase HIV testing amongst a very small but often stigmatized population, our students developed messages and tools that spoke specifically to that audience, and the work really transcended the comfort zone of public health. And then finally, when Whole Foods Market challenged the students to rethink and reuse their vinyl marketing banners to keep them out of the landfill, our students came up with the compost ball, a product that not only aligned with the brand, the Whole Foods brand, but also had the opportunity to turn waste into revenues. But for me, as an educator and as a designer, I'm actually the most excited about seeing what our students do with these skills after they leave the institution. So how do they forge their own professional pathways? So Lauren, for example, who's a product designer at change.org, she really gained the confidence in the center to pursue social design as a career. And I'm happy to say that since pulling together this presentation, Lauren has been recruited by internet.org, which is a global partnership looking to bring internet access to the two-thirds of the world's population that doesn't yet have it. Next, Ryan, designer at Google. So Ryan really learned and was sort of forced to learn the collaborative approach, and he realized how integral that was when you're working on real issues with real partners and expecting to make real impact in your community. Or Becky, who's now lead designer and design strategist at Teach for America. Becky learned that, you know, as a designer, it's much more than just coming up with creative ideas, that those ideas have to be sustainable, strategic, and implementable. Or finally, Chris, he's now senior designer and art director at Kickstarter. And Chris really learned to look more critically at the role of the designer and really dig into the reasons why we make what we make. And our institution sees the value in our work. So since 2008, when we launched the Center for Design Practice, we've developed a one-year Master of Arts in Social Design graduate program, a fully funded postgraduate fellows program, and I'm very happy to share and announce that in fall 2014, we will be moving all those entities into a unified Center for Social Design. And this will be our the next iteration of our vision for activating a community of creative change makers. So thank you so much.
Our final of the six 2014 awardees is the MidCorps program at Middlebury College. And representing MidCorps, please welcome Jessica Holmes.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. Thank you. Okay. One step closer.
Took us six times. We just got good at the photo now.
Does that mean I'll have the best picture?
Exactly.
Okay. Well, thank you so very much. It's an honor to be here, and we're so incredibly grateful for this award. It's humbling, actually, to go last, to go behind all these incredible leaders in social entrepreneurship education and to, in fact, stand before all of you and talk about our program. So thank you so much. So I thought I would actually start this short talk by sharing with you a quotation from a student that took MidCorps last January. And his name is Alec McMillan, and this is what he wrote to us in a thank you note that he sent a couple of weeks, or a couple of days after the first, after the class. I'm walking away from this course with a lot of amazing things, but I think the most significant one is a new self-perception. Before MidCorps, I never thought of myself as a risk taker, or an entrepreneur, or a public speaker, or an idea guy. But after this month, I've seen that I can be all those things, and I really think I found this new self-awareness thanks to MidCorps. 8 months later, Alec, a self-proclaimed introvert, was selected to be the sole speaker, student speaker, at Middlebury's TEDx conference. So shocking. But Alec is not alone. What we find is that many students find the MidCorps experience to be transformative, that students learn to build the skills, they earn the confidence, and they gain the networks that they need to engage the world. So let me tell you a little about MidCorps. MidCorps is a four-week-long leadership and innovation program that takes place at Middlebury College campus in January, and on the beautiful shores of Lake Tahoe on the Sierra Nevada campus in June. The program in June is open to students from any institution and even recent graduates up to 4 years out of college. The MidCorps curriculum is carefully designed to build the core strengths that we believe the next generation of leaders and innovators needs to become change makers. These core strengths include leadership, collaboration, strategic thinking, persuasive communication, financial literacy, negotiation, crisis management, idea creation, design thinking, visual communication, networking, empathy, ethical decision making, and self-reflection. Now, I'm sure you're all wondering how on earth you can possibly do this in a four-week-long period, right? In a four-week-long, semester-long class. I'm going to let you in on four secrets about MidCorps. MidCorps is intensive, it's mentor-driven, it's experiential, and it's cohort-based. Let's start with the first one. MidCorps is intensive. MidCorps meets 8 hours a day, 5 days a week, for 4 weeks. That's a total of 160 hours. To put into perspective, the typical semester-long class meets for 40 hours. So one MidCorps class is the equivalent of four semester classes. That gives us a lot of time to build those core strengths. The second secret is that MidCorps is mentor-driven. We carefully select experts and practitioners to develop hands-on workshops to build those core strengths. So in the course of 1 month, students will learn leadership from former governors and executive leadership coaches. They will learn multicultural collaboration from the Foreign Secretary of Mexico and the former CEO of Microsoft Asia. They will learn about persuasive communication from the former press secretary for the Obama campaign. And they'll learn about how to ideate and how to validate their ideas from the co-founder of Netflix. and they will learn about social entrepreneurship from inspiring Ashoka fellows like Catherine Hall Trujillo and Alyssa Del Tufo. Over the course of that 1 month, a group of 16 mid-course students will have the opportunity to work with 60 to 70 different mentors from different fields, backgrounds, interests, industries, over the course of that month in the classroom, in workshops, and in across meals at mealtime, over breakfasts, lunches, and dinners. They'll connect and they'll share life stories and life's lessons. That leads me to the third secret about mid-course. It's experiential. Many of you already know in this room the power of experiential learning. Everything we do in mid-core is hands-on. Students learn by doing. They learn to lead and collaborate by working in teams. They learn to persuasively communicate by engaging in improv exercises, story-making workshops, and idea pitches. They learn to, they practice negotiation by practicing conflict resolution. They learn how to handle the unexpected by managing simulated crises. And they set their own moral compass by facing ethical dilemmas. They learn how to strategically think by using the tools of human-centered design thinking to tackle real strategic problems by partner organizations. For example, mid-course students worked with Achievement First to design a nationwide campaign to celebrate first-generation college graduates. They worked with Birthing Project USA to develop new creative ways to connect with volunteers and funders and participants. And they worked with Mercy Connections to develop a new social venture that would not only raise revenue for the organization, but would also empower and employ their participants. Over the course of that 1 month, the students are also invited and, in fact, challenged to come up with a new idea of their own, a new product or a service, a new way to deliver an existing product or a service, or a solution to a social problem. And over the course of those 4 weeks, the students are given the tools to learn how to ideate, to learn how to validate, and to learn how to communicate those ideas. That leads me to the fourth secret about mid-core, cohort-style learning. Over the course of these 4 weeks, the students are living together, learning together, working together, all day, every day, in and out for 4 weeks. They learn to support one another through the daily challenges and, indeed, the daily failures they may face. And that leads us to a fifth surprise secret that I didn't tell you I was going to tell you about, but here it is. It's about failing forward. Failing forward is a mantra in mid-core. Today's college student arrives on that college campus having done all the right things to get to that college campus, that highly selective process that requires them to take the right classes, to choose the right extracurricular activities, to avoid failure. In mid-core, we want to change that around. We want to give them a safe space where they can actually learn how to fail forward, how they can take risks, how they can move outside their comfort zone. We celebrate failure. We embrace failure. In fact, we embrace it so much that we have literally have a failure wall in every classroom of mid-core. This is a failure wall where we ask students, mentors, faculty to tell us about a time in their life when they failed, what they learned from that failure, and sign their name. Own it. Fail forward. Learn from it, but fail forward. So I hope that what I've been able to share with you a little bit tonight or today is a sense of this intensive, how this intensive, mentor-driven, experiential, cohort-based learning model that takes place in a fail-safe environment can be transformative for students like Alec and many others. It turns out that our own perceptions of ourselves as idea guys, as entrepreneurs, as leaders, as public speakers can be changed through programs like mid-core. And it is our hope that we can leave, mid-core students leave with a leader's toolkit, an entrepreneurial mindset, a newfound confidence, and a sense of a capacity to deal with the unknown, and a network of incredible mentors that will help them out along the way. So I thought I would leave you all with some reflections about what our mid-core students this past month said about their mid-core experience. So thank you so much for allowing us this opportunity to talk about our program, and to Ashoka, you and the Cordes Foundation for this wonderful award. We're humbled.
Beautiful day. Very nice.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Wow. Leaves me with just two questions. So my first question is, where was all this amazing stuff when I was in school 30 years ago? Looking out at some of the other folks in the audience my age, think of everything we would have accomplished if we had the access to great programs like that. And second, I'm looking forward to the networking discussion to seeing if there's an upper age limit to some of these programs, because I'd like to go. So, as we conclude the innovation session and awards this morning, we do want to change directions for just a minute. On December 20th of last year, the field of social entrepreneurship lost one of our pioneers, one of our groundbreakers, and one of our innovators in Greg Dees. And many of us lost a friend, a mentor, an advisor, and a colleague. So as we thought about how we could best honor Greg's legacy at this Ashoka Exchange, it just seems so fitting because of who he is and what he's done and what he represents that we shared that legacy at the conclusion of our Innovation Awards presentation. So what I'd like to do is bring up Matt Nash. Matt is one of the leaders of, a former colleague of Greg, a leader of the campus-wide social entrepreneurship initiative at Duke, for some remarks and a short video, and then he'll be followed by some closing comments from Ashoka's president, Diana Wells. Matt.
Thanks, Ron. Thanks, Ron. I was just thinking that the last time I saw you, Ron, was at dinner with Greg a couple years ago when you were visiting campus with some students and other faculty colleagues. So I appreciate this opportunity. As Ron said, on December 20th, we lost someone in the field of social entrepreneurship who was a pioneer, an advocate, a true change maker, a mentor, and friend. But with the passing of Greg Dees, we lost someone much more important than just a thought leader or inspiring teacher. We lost an extraordinarily kind, compassionate, humble man of great integrity, as many of those of you who had a chance to know Greg may have known. A true social entrepreneur working tirelessly within the academy, Greg, I like to say, was the Johnny Appleseed of social entrepreneurship. From his earliest days teaching at Yale School of Management and having his students say, why can't we do nonprofit projects within the entrepreneurship course, to then moving over to Harvard and starting the first known course on social entrepreneurship, and he helped launch the Initiative on Social Enterprise. Later moving to Stanford as the co-founder of the Center for Social Innovation, and then coming to Duke at last in 2001, where he co-founded our Center for the Advancement of Social Entrepreneurship. Greg was the Johnny Appleseed, and along the way, he seeded innovations, fertilized ecosystems, harvested knowledge in ways too numerous to mention here. Although I never had the benefit of having Greg as a professor, I had the great joy of working with him for the past 9 years, and he was my teacher and mentor on a daily basis. It's really not an overstatement to say he changed my life, and like for those of you who may have had a chance to work with Greg, you are fortunate to count yourself among the D's mentees, as we used to say. We thought the best way to pay just a few moments of tribute to him today were perhaps through the words of a few of those students he touched over the years who gave those aha moments, as Ron said earlier. So if you could join us for about 2.5 minutes and hear a few of our students and their thoughts on Greg and his passing.
When I think of Greg, I think of just a guy who lent legitimacy and identity to the academic field of social entrepreneurship. And even just reflect upon my time sort of in Durham, just making social entrepreneurship something that, that MBA students thought about, right? They think about how to sort of apply their skills and their passions in a really impactful way and something that will give meaning to their careers. And Greg made it that much easier for us that we're sort of evangelizing, you know, people pursue careers in the sector. He made it easier for us to say, hey, there's some great examples of great people out there.
Desire to see the world become a place in which our children can grow free and strong. We are bound together by the task that stands before us and the road that lies ahead. We are bound and we are bound. There is a feeling like the clenching of a fist. There is a hunger in the center of the chest. There is a passage through the darkness and the mist. And though the body sleeps, the heart will never rest.
Long before I ever knew Greg personally, or Fuqua for that matter, Greg's work, his writing, and his thought leadership in articulating and formulating the field of social entrepreneurship had a great impact on my life and my work in the nonprofit sector. If it weren't for Greg, I never would have come to Fuqua. Knowing what he was doing there with CASE was an immediate draw, and it's greatly benefited my life and my career as I continue to pursue impact investing. And I'm eternally grateful to him and wish Greg eternal peace and his family great happiness.
Don't see me no light, no doubt, no. Don't give me no light from the TV screen. No, no, no. When I open my eyes, I want to drink my
just say a few words. Greg has been a co-builder with Ashoka, a thought partner, a leader, someone who brings purpose to everybody he encounters. He helped the field move beyond anecdote to rigor through case studies by showing what works, what doesn't work, and asking the questions why. Field building needs that. Examples aren't enough. And the work that he did through CASE helped push those boundaries, helped us all rethink. In 2008, with partnership with the Aspen Institute, Ashoka was able to award Greg the Pioneer for Social Entrepreneurship Education Award at a gathering at CASE. And I was asked to join the CASE board in 2005 and had the privilege of seeing how Greg's personal qualities inspired the trusted network that he let free in the world. He did helped build the Open Innovation Society that he began to see, that the individual examples are not enough, that we have to build an ecosystem. He did that through his leadership at CASE, he did it through his students, he did it through the partners and peers to grow the field, and so that we have the rigor, the analytical rigor for what works, so we have the CASE, beyond CASE studies, to think through what are the institutional supports that are really going to take the field to the next level. There's no better way to honor his legacy than for all of us to go back to our institutions and not only ask the questions of what are the pieces of the ecosystem that don't yet appear, but also to ask the purpose question of ourselves and our colleagues.
Now we've wrapped up the first morning keynote. So thank you, everybody. And for those who are eager and running out the door to talk to all the Innovation Award winners, there is one of the many sessions next is a networking session where you can talk to them, figure out how you can work with them, replicate their ideas, but then look at your program for all the other options and enjoy the rest of the day. Thank you.